Okay.
We're refreshed and back, ready to complete the second half of this album. Look, it's a physical and mental task to try and even put into words this album. Always so much
There's
to
always
say.
There's always so much to say.
Okay, so we're up to This Is Me Trying.
Yep.
Great song to jump back into. This song is so beautiful, so vulnerable. I really feel like this is Taylor, this is almost her saying this to like the public and to the fans.
Yeah. I've also thought the possibility of her wanting to talk to her albums as well.
Yeah. Or
which
saying
is a whole
it.
Thing.
Yeah, like, yeah. Well, let's just get into the song.
Yeah, let's just get into
and
the song.
And start talking about the lyrics. To say.
So much to say.
I actually
want to preface this by saying that like since the album first came out, this has gone higher and higher and higher on my list. It's one of my favorites. I really have realized that I love this song, which is interesting given that I don't have a full complete picture of what it's even about.
Yes.
You know, I guess you and I are the type of people who we don't necessarily listen to music because we relate to a song. Like I don't love a song because I relate to a song necessarily. I can, but I can also love a song for many other reasons. And I always love to know where the artist is coming from, as well as apply my own feelings to it.
It feels like she's definitely trying to share the weight of something through this song. And, you know, in those first lyrics, she says, I had the shiniest wheels, now they're rusting. So I guess that could be towards her career or, you know, potentially even just like her innocence and like how she went through so much and how she's kind of come out on the other side a bit rusted because of what she's been through. I didn't know if you'd care if I came back. I have a lot of regrets about that. We definitely feel and know that maybe there was a period where she thought she was going to disappear.
And she also, as I've spoken about as well, references like, you know, I potentially if like fans coming back to her and in cardigans.
Yeah.
So like, I mean,
it
definitely
could be. And I have a lot of regrets about that. Like even like, I can't believe I doubted that. Cause now it feels like she's really found such a happy place with being famous and like being able to share her music with her fans. Seems like it's literally the highlight of her life.
Yeah. And I think she's come to a place where she's realized now and accepted that her fans are not going to go anywhere.
No.
Yeah. How do I just stop caring?
Yeah.
I think she knows that now. Like I feel like she really for a while just assumed that she's not going to be able to hold on to the fame that she's or the success that she's had in the past forever.
Well, like and almost every other female pop star, they have phases, and Taylor Swift has managed to stay so relevant for so long.
Yeah,
of course she would have those fears. Like and she kind of says that in Mirable as well. Like, is how long is this really going to keep going for? How long can I ride this
and
wave?
And she's right to think that way because most artists don't have the longevity that she's had. Like, why would you assume that you're going to continue to be as successful as you were the previous album and the previous album and the previous album? Like, that doesn't just happen to people.
But it really feels like in this album, she's understanding that if I just keep doing me, my fans are going to be there with me.
Yep.
And like, I can't believe I thought that they wouldn't. Of course they will.
They'll always be there. Totally.
That is contender for the saddest lyric on the album.
If it's not in My Tears Ricochet, I Can Go Anywhere I Want, Just Not Home.
Yeah, it's this.
That?
Yeah.
I pulled the car off the road to the lookout. Could have followed my fears all the way down.
Yeah, it's obviously a very, very deep lyric. Like talking about, you know, standing on the edge of a cliff and like thinking it would just be easier to end it all. Like that's kind of where my head goes when she says that. That's why I think it's so powerful because she has those elements of in this song, and then she turns it around and says, like, this is me trying. Like,
and this is why I find it funny that there are a lot of people online still being like, you know, she said that this album is full of stories and stuff like that, like, stop trying to apply it to her life. And it's like, how can you just not apply it to her life?
No, no.
Like, so many songs are applicable to her life.
Yeah.
Like, and even if she's wanted to deflect that, it doesn't change that that's what it is. Yeah. Maybe I don't quite know what to
say, but I'm here in your doorway. It's just that lyric there, which is, I'm here in your doorway. That's where it definitely could be taken back to, like, a relationship metaphor.
Yes.
But I also think it could be, like, a metaphor for her being, like, again, like, I'm here, I'm putting my heart on my sleeve with this album. Like, she's like, I always present myself to the world, and this is me trying, like, through my music, if that makes sense. Like, she's obviously going through such a hard time. She's like, I don't really even quite know what to say, but I'm here and I'm giving you this and I'm doing this. And, you know, this album was even maybe a little bit of a out of her comfort zone in the way that she dropped it and the way that she released it. It was really hard to probably let go of the fact that Lover had been ended short and, you know, all these things had happened. It would be so hard to make that choice to go, no, I'm going to release this album even though it's not the perfect scenario.
Yeah,
totally. But I'm going to roll with that anyway.
Yeah.
And this is me trying to do the best under all circumstances that
totally.
I have. And she's always been good at that.
Yeah.
Taking things and just...
She rolls with it, and I think that's why she can continue to be so successful, to your point before.
Yeah.
Like, she's always just been herself, and she changes as she grows rather than trying to keep doing the same thing she's always done because it's worked for her in the past. She changes and evolves, and that works for her.
Mm, it does. And that's what makes her special.
100%.
Simple lyric for a chorus.
Mm.
I just wanted you to know that this is me trying.
Mm.
What's there to say? Thank you for letting me know that.
Thank you for trying. I appreciate your effort.
I really do appreciate the efforts.
Yeah.
Like, I am so grateful you keep trying. This is the simplicity of that lyric carries the power behind it, carries the vulnerability behind it. Personal lyrics.
Yeah.
They told me all of my cages were mental, so I got wasted like all of my potential. This lyric confuses me a little bit because in a way I'm like, I don't ever feel like her potential has been wasted.
I think she more means that, like, she's always been like, whenever she's been, I guess, belittled or disrespected or she maybe hasn't defended herself because she doesn't want to be like that girl or whatever, she's kind of feeling like her potential was wasted more in a personal sense than in an artistic sense. Like,
I think I agree. I think that makes a lot of sense. And then obviously the next lyric, and my words shoot to kill when I'm mad, I have a lot of regrets about that, definitely ties us back to, once again, being a very personal lyric, because she said things like that many a times, like even once again with the... I never leave well enough alone.
Yeah, and it ties in well coming in after the first lyrics of that verse because it's kind of like these thoughts and feelings and these times that she hasn't said anything and she's let her potential be wasted and built up into anger where sometimes she just reacts.
Yes.
And then it doesn't end up being in the way that she really wanted it to be because it's just come out rather than...
She didn't have the
because
right.
she's angry that she didn't maybe do it last time or...
Well, and she hadn't quite figured out the best way to communicate her feelings because she obviously felt really trapped, like in cages and stuff like that. So it's very frustrating when you feel like you want to say something and you're not saying it in the way that's working the best for you. And she's gotten so good at that.
Yeah.
She's gotten so much better
at
that. She really knows exactly what to say now. And it's like you even see it in interviews when someone asks her something. She's like, she stops and like pauses for a second and then she says the most perfect thing. And you're God, that was good. She just managed to compose that and take that and express herself so perfectly. She's so good at that now. I really admire that about her.
She really is.
Interesting lyrics.
Yeah, very interesting.
interesting lyrics.
I definitely think that when she refers to pouring out my heart to a stranger, she's more talking about like going to therapy.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, because sometimes I think that about even in her songs.
Oh, like she's pouring her heart out, like, to strangers. To us.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Because think about how maybe the therapy thing, that could be it as well.
Yeah.
And then she says, I was so ahead of the curve became a sphere. So, and sometimes I feel like she definitely did go through phases of, like, not learning from her mistakes. Or she said that as well, like, I never learn, bridges burn, like, all those kind of lyrics before. So maybe that's tying into, like, going through so many cycles and being ahead of things and... it end up coming back to her, biting her or something like that.
Even in the second verse, like before she goes through that whole bit, she's obviously talking about like having her potential wasted potentially in a personal setting where she hasn't stood up for herself.
Yeah.
And then, so then she learned to be ahead of the curve.
Yeah.
And then that has backfired on her.
Yeah.
Fell behind all my classmates and it ended up here.
Yeah.
Like, it's like she then tried the other way and that's kind of not working as well either. And now she just has to come back to this grounded place of just like rediscovering what she wants and how she wants to handle situations and how she wants to react to things. Because it's like both sides didn't work. It's like totally. Not saying anything was a waste, but then being too ahead of myself and trying to, you know, be quick-witted or prepare myself fully for what's going to come my way, being ahead of everyone else is also exhausting and draining, and it's just that's also not working.
And I feel like she definitely did have that about her because she wanted to prove herself.
Yeah.
I think about that a lot with 1989 because I feel like even though she was pushing to be the best, it kind of did fall back into that cycle of...
Well, the whole ending of that era ended up being one of the worst parts of her life. I don't even necessarily think that she relates that necessarily to the album, but definitely trying to be ahead of the game made her, got her to the place of making that album. She became extremely popular, extremely successful, the height of her fame at the time.
Yeah.
And then it did kind of end up all coming crashing down.
Yeah, so. And it's funny that she's saying that lyric in an album like this because this album is so ahead of her time, but it doesn't feel... like it's trying to be.
No, it feels very honest and very grounded. And I mean,
it's just come naturally now.
Yes.
She's learning herself so much better.
Yeah, totally. I love that bridge. I love the melody of the bridge. The bridge
is what throws me a little bit.
The lyrics is what throws me there as well because I actually feel like maybe the bridge is most applicable to the possibility of her being like trying to get back her albums or something like that, because it's like she doesn't want to be anywhere. Like she's...
Because the lyrics are kind of like breakup-ish in a way. Like, it's hard to be at a party when I feel like an open wound. It's hard to be anywhere when all I want is you. You're a flashback on a film reel on the one screen in my town. So, you know, those are kind of... those are giving me exile vibes as well because, like, she's talked about film and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And if we are applying, you know, all of the motivation behind these breakup songs... The breakup with her albums or losing her albums or whatever, it makes sense that she could be talking about that here as well. Like, she would feel like an open wound because...
This is her biggest... public...
Yeah.
Like, she's hurting and it's very public.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And it's like, you know, I'm sure for her, when she's going through something like this, this is going to be a topic of conversation if she's out and about, like that sort of thing.
And it would be, like she said, a constant reminder of the old albums or of Scott or whatever, because there's so many things in her life that would remind her of... all of the time. Imagine all the times and all the things that they've experienced together.
Yeah.
She would just have constant flashbacks of that.
Yeah.
So.
But then it's like, as we say, like, I feel like the rest of the song is almost more personal, reflecting on herself. So I just don't know.
On her career as well. Like, I guess it is all about the struggles that she's overcome. When you break down each lyric, they're all about different individual struggles that she's had to overcome in a way. So. Yeah. Yeah, I guess it just makes sense. Like, it can't really be pinpointed to an exact thing that she's trying to overcome, but it's just, I think it's just her trying to get through life.
Yeah.
The actual melody of the way that bridge starts, like, there's lots of music before it. Like we were just saying, there's lots of music
lots
in this
of
song.
Music.
And
yes.
I feel like they're really like those.
And it's like subtle but dramatic at the same time
yeah.
as well.
And I feel like those allow you to kind of sit in the emotion of what she just said before it builds to the next thing.
Yeah.
The bridge is kind of like a bit ranty and a bit random. And then the way she goes back into the chorus. Is also like a little bit unexpected in a way.
Yeah.
So I really quite like how that builds.
Yes, me too.
Just like how in The Last Great American Dynasty when she like fucks you up with that. I had a marvelous time.
Yes, how it's all different. Yes, yes.
I feel similarly to the at least I'm trying here. Because it's just, we needed that. It's almost like we needed that, like...
It's like a release.
That release of energy, because this has been building to that point. And it's just so beautiful. It just makes you feel things. I mean, all of these songs make you feel things. I think a beautiful way to end the song, because it's like I'm trying to get through this, but at least I'm trying.
Yeah,
like that trying is all we can really do at the end of the day, and like that's something that we have to be proud of.
Yeah, very vulnerable song.
It's track 5 material.
I feel like almost every song is.
Well, it is an honestly, album. It is an album. It's track 5, and we literally said that the first time we listened.
Literally.
Okay, moving on to Illicit Affairs.
Illicit Affairs is another one that I am stuck on, and it makes sense that. Maybe this is one of the ones where it really is written from a different perspective rather than her own. It doesn't feel like it fits into her life.
Yeah,
in a way.
I agree. I would love to know your guys' opinion on that.
Because I love this song.
I love this song too.
And I think it's a song that a lot of people can relate to in their own personal way. Just trying to like understand the context from like the writer's perspective.
Yeah.
Like I'd love to know where she was coming from when she came up with this concept.
I
was just thinking that. Love the guitar in this song.
It gives me like leaves rustling vibe.
Oh my god, that's actually what it is. It's like
it's
rustling
like,
the leaves.
Yeah,
it is.
And it's somehow made it into a guitar sound.
Oh, it's really pretty.
Yeah,
it's really pretty.
Glistering leaves.
Make sure nobody sees you leave. Hood over your head, keep your eyes down. Tell your friends you're out for a run.
So far, she's pretty much just talking about having a secretive thing going on. Tell your friends you're out for a run on the down low.
Tell yourself you can always stop.
Interesting lyric.
What started in beautiful rooms ends with meetings in parking lots.
That lyric. Tell yourself you can always stop. I find interesting considering later on in the song she brings in the lyric. A drug that only worked the first few hundred times.
Yes.
Because it's like, it kind of is like that, like, especially if it's like an affair kind of situation.
Yeah.
It's like, you can kind of fall into it being like, you know, this is just some fun. Like,
I can
we can always stop. It's not going to be anything serious. Like, cause you know that like it really can't get anything more serious.
And you're so scared to face them, I guess you would be.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, The lyric, what started in beautiful rooms, ending in meetings and parking lots, threw me at first because that was when I first thought, oh, maybe this is like about even Tom Hiddleston or something, because like they met at the Met Gala, obviously, beautiful rooms, and then like, I don't know, parking lots just gave me getaway car vibes for some reason. Mm-hmm. I can't pin realistically who she could be singing this song about in her life.
It kind of could be Tom. Like, it could be.
That's the thing about illicit affairs and clandestine meetings and longing stares. It's born from just one single glance, but it dies and it dies and it dies a million little times.
She's talking about, like, I guess the fire burning out.
Yeah.
When you first meet someone, it feels so forbidden and dangerous and fun and exciting and, like, I guess... That's the kind of emotions that are wrapped up in this song, and then slowly they fade and they dwindle and they die.
Yeah.
Which is obviously a very relatable thing for a lot of people.
Yeah, totally.
Leave the perfume on the shelf. that you picked out just for him, so you leave no trace behind, like you don't even exist.
This lyric also threw me for so long, because I'm like, is she talking about like at a shop she's picked out a perfume for someone? And she's like, no, can't, I'm not going to give that to them, because giving that to them is like showing that we're connected, and we're not connected, it's not a real thing. Like, is that kind of the thing that you would think when you're elite, like when you're having an illicit affair with someone? I guess it kind of would be, right? Because you're not in a relationship, so you wouldn't be those little things, like you might think to get them for something. You don't do those things.
Yeah.
Take the words for what they are, a dwindling mercurial high, a drug that only worked the first few hundred times.
Who are you talking about?
Yeah, dwindling is never a good word to use for a love or a relationship, because it's obviously fading. Take the words for what they are. It's almost like, don't overthink it. This is what it is. The drug that only worked the first few hundred times. So that was the lyric that when I first heard, I was like, this can't be about Joe, unless they had broken up, which obviously they haven't.
Mm. Not like she hasn't on past albums written a lot of songs that are make-believe because of a situation that's in her mind. Mm. So it's entirely possible that this is not anything except a story she wanted to write.
And you want to scream, don't call me kid, don't call me baby. Look at this godforsaken mess that you made me. You showed me colors you know I can't see with anyone else.
Oh, obviously the bridge is the best part of the song.
Oh, the bridge is the best part of the song. Yeah, it is.
This whole bit where it picks up, you can really start to feel her frustration at this situation. Don't call me kid, don't call me baby. Look at this godforsaken mess that you've made me.
Look at this idiotic fool that you made me. You taught me secret language I can't speak with anyone else.
I just think that the lyric choices in both of those, that those two parts of the bridge are really special. I just love the way she said that, you know, it's about the colors that you can't show me and the language that we had. And that's what it feels like sometimes when you have such a deep connection with someone. Like, it's like, how am I meant to continue on when, like, I can't do this with anyone.
No, those lyrics are very applicable even to like a longer term relationship, an affair. So I think that makes it even more relatable sometimes. Yeah. Just being a long term relationship, like, it's fucking hard to then try and move on from that person when like they were your whole world for so long and then they're not anymore. And it's like, I'm sorry, what do you mean? You taught me a secret language I can't speak with anyone else. Like, I can fully relate to that.
Absolutely. And
just being like, I don't talk to anyone like I talk to you, and now I don't have that.
Yeah, exactly.
What the fuck?
I know. And that's what I mean. Like, it really, those lyric, the choice of lyric and the melody that she's in that bridge really taps into that so perfectly. And I think that's why the bridge is everyone's favorite part.
Totally.
And then obviously it just goes into this part.
And you know,
interesting that she chose those lyrics to end it on it as well, because like
she's always like saying like I'd go back,
and also I did whatever it took to be with you kind of thing, even if it was ruining myself. The bridge is so good, you almost want to hear it again, but it makes perfect sense that you don't get it.
100%. No, it does make perfect sense that you don't get it again.
I think it's the beauty of the song.
Totally,
because it's all building up to that point.
Yep.
And then it just ends so quickly after it.
Yeah, that's it.
So unexpectedly. Anyway, great song. Next song is Invisible String. This is one of our favorites.
Absolutely one of the faves. I think, again, because this one is like so clearly about her and Joe, which gives that kind of perspective.
Yeah.
And I think that's why a lot of fans have ended up loving it, because it's just that like confirmation that of course they're still together, but also like we just love to know what the fuck is happening in their relationship.
Yeah, exactly.
We just want to know.
You know, especially because there were so many songs on the album that at first listen, you're like,
why is there so many breakup songs?
Yeah. So it's really good to still get Invisible String and also Peace. And obviously they feel like, to me, the only two songs that are super obviously about Joe.
Yeah.
The Lakes definitely has elements of Joe in there as well, which we'll get to. But yeah, this is just a love song, and it's so clever.
Like, it's so, so clever. Oh, okay.
Oh, such a legal guitar sound. Thank you, Aaron.
So good.
Green was the color.
I just want to say the way she's singing to this sound of the guitar is so not obvious. If you guys haven't seen, Aaron actually put up a clip of him playing this guitar ages ago, and he was singing a completely different song on top of it. Mm. And then obviously he gave Taylor this track, seeing if she would do something with it, and she came back with this song. Different the both of them sung over the top of it, which always kind of fucks me up a little bit, like how singers manage to create a melody on top of a track or an instrument, because it's not obvious.
Yeah, I find writing to track just like a concept that I can't fathom. Like the fact that this, like, majority of this album has been written to track is just so wild.
I know.
And it's like the first time we know for sure that she did that was with I Wish You Would on 1989, because she spoke about it on her voice memo.
Yeah.
And that already fucked me up back then.
Yeah,
and now
absolutely.
To know that she's like written to track to all this, I'm just like, I don't understand how a song of lyrics can come to you when you hear me.
The way she's worded this whole song as well, like the choice of sentences are very interesting. She's not like being like, I was sitting on the grass and it was green. It was like green was the color of the grass. Like the way she's kind of wording that is really cool. And I love how she keeps that throughout all the verses and manages to make it work so perfectly. Obviously, once again, she's tying in, you know, green was the grass and teal was the color, like Joe's color of his shirt that he, and we know that the song is definitely about Joe for many reasons, but he did work at a yogurt shop when he was 16. So really cute that she's throwing in those details. Yeah. And I just find it so funny that she does that kind of stuff. Like you can just imagine her being like,
excellent, I'm going to use that.
Excellent,
song,
yeah. That like, I know thank that you. Information. Like, it's great. Yeah, teal, that was the color. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to, what can I make that work? What did I used to do that was green? I used to sit on the grass and green. I'll make that work.
Yeah, totally. Time, give me no compasses, give me no signs. Were there clues I didn't see? And isn't it just so pretty to think all along there was some invisible string tying you to me? Yeah, so pretty much the whole song is her saying, is her going through her life and his life and kind of like comparing them side by side next to each other and, you know, saying, isn't it just so crazy that we were always going to collide?
Yeah.
And was there clues that I missed that showed that, and we always had this string connecting us?
One of my favorite things about this song is how the chorus changes every single time. It kind of builds with the story as well. Like the first one is kind of like, oh my God, time, it's so curious, it's so weird, like these things happen, like I had no fucking idea that these are going to happen. And as it goes on, she becomes more concrete and more solid in what she's learned and who she's become, which I find really cool as well.
Yes. That was the plot of the song in the cab on your first trip to LA. You ate at my favorite spot for dinner. That is, I find that lyric so interesting because it's like, we didn't even pick up on the fact that she said bad was the blood of the song in the cab on their first trip. The first time we heard it, like, hello, she's referencing bad blood.
Yeah. True. And it's the way she's worded it is so clever as well. So it's really...
Well, maybe that's why. Yeah, because she's at bad was the blood of the song in the cab. Like, I don't think my mind first made the connection of bad blood because, like, those words are, like, separated
absolutely.
In that sentence.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And
it's
isn't
so
that also just so wild to think that Joe was literally in a cab listening to bad blood on his first trip to LA and that he had no idea that he was going to end up with her.
Oh my God.
And
like,
especially
I was
in that era as well. Like, she was just so big when Bad Blood was out.
I was just thinking the other day, like, it's so crazy how, like, he would have heard that song on his first trip to LA and then not known that her next album would be about him.
Yeah. Wow. So crazy.
So crazy. Gold was the richest on a 3-year trip. Getting
in the lakes there, which we love because that was the first time we'd heard those words and we knew that there was a song called The Lakes coming, and it's so great that that song also encompasses Joe so much as well, because yeah, this is the first time we're getting that picture of them by the lakes having lunch, knowing what they kind of do together.
Yes.
And how they spend their time. So that's really beautiful as well.
She's obviously referencing the lakes. So, but like, is it the same lakes? Like, is that where they were on their pre-year trip that made her think of the lakes? Like, I don't know.
Well, yeah, I don't know either. I would love to know that. And I'd love to know how long they've been going, if that's like a holiday kind of stuff for them or something. Yeah,
totally.
Lyrics in the whole song, cutting me open and healing me fine, like yes, time does that. Time cuts you open and heals you fine, and like it's just so beautiful to hear her say that because of everything that she's been through, and especially in regards to relationships, like she's healed. Thank you so much, and
I mean specifically the lyric in All Too Well where she says time won't fly, it's like I'm paralyzed by it, and it's like her just affirming, I mean, we've known for a very long time that she's over Jake, but like her just affirming that, like, actually I've learned all and grown and realized that actually time does heal things.
You know,
I'm not gonna always feel that pit of despair that I felt when I wrote this song.
And she didn't know that at the time because she hadn't quite, like, I guess like heartbreak for her was still something that she was trying to process and like get over. Like she hadn't had enough time to have known that.
Totally.
Really does heal things because you need time. And that's what we were saying the other day about how interesting it is being in your late 20s, because it's really the first time that you have all these different chapters of your life that you can look back on and be like, oh my God, time has passed and time is weird and I feel so different. And like, when you're young, you struggle to comprehend that so much more.
Yeah.
Which was why it makes so much sense that she's writing this kind of song now.
And I feel like it makes perfect sense for her to continuously be relating to time in the choruses of this song. And specifically that lyric, cutting me open and healing me fine, because it was only in meeting Joe, and actually she kind of is talking about it in this song, that like she's realized that it was so fucking obvious that like I was meant to be with this guy all along.
Yeah, yeah.
That it's like, it makes every other bad relationship that all experience with a guy that I've had in the past
seem
fine.
Yeah, totally.
Like, of course I'm healed now because I realize that I'm with the person I'm meant to be with. So it makes all of that okay.
Well, absolutely right. And it's kind of like what we were saying last night. Like, it's so weird. We don't know who we're going to end up with or where we're going to be. But one day we will. And it's, it'll be like, looking it's like, back oh, yeah. like this.
Makes
like,
sense. Makes sense why I had to go through all of that to get here.
To pause it right there, because she says, and we picked up on this I think the first time we listened to it, when she says you know, pulled me out of all the wrong into that dive bar.
Oh yes, so we did. We did pick up on this in the
first. That's a big indicator to Joe. Yeah, because it's delicate dive bar. Yeah, you said where you at. So, we know she's definitely talking about Joe here. And it's interesting how she's going through this in the bridge. She's going through all of her past mistakes and all the things that managed to happen to keep Joe or to get Joe. Gold, Joe reference.
Yes.
And we love that now the gold is this string that tied them together, and she can see how it was all meant to happen to lead to him.
Yep, totally.
Crazy that this is the same sound the whole way through the song. Cold was the steel of my axe to grind for the boys who broke my heart. Now I send their baby's present. We did pick up on this the first time we listened to it as well.
Being Joe Jonas, who's just had a baby.
Yes. So we love that. We love that she's able to reflect on, wow, I was so fucking mad at Joe.
Yeah.
When we broke up.
I love that she's able to have like a good relationship with some of her exes as well.
It's
It doesn't always have to be how you felt when you broke up. You can and go back and be friends and it's fine.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Love
and like
that.
If you don't know, she wrote a lot of sad breakup songs about Joe, like even like Forever and Always is a great example of that.
Mm-hmm.
And she was really fucking hurt when he broke up with her, and she kind of even publicly blasted him a little bit. So it's great to see those times that you remember or you know as being really painful and sad for her, she can now be like,
That's fine. Yeah.
Because it was That's part okay. of life, and now I send their babies presents. Yep. Like, woo!
Gold was the color of the leaves when I showed you around Centennial Park. Hell was the journey, but it brought me heaven.
Oh, I love that lyric too.
One of the best lyrics on the whole album. But you know how we were saying, like, oh, I wonder why gold or whatever. But I think there's obviously multiple reasons why it was gold, and because of maybe the feeling that it gave her, or like we said, kind of like daylight clarity. Mm-hmm. But that is another thing, like maybe it was simple things like that. Like gold was the color of the leaves. And I remember that being a thing like that I picked up on when we were going around to Centennial Park, and that matched the feeling you were giving me.
Yep.
So it feels like she's kind of putting into place like, gold with the color, like that. This is why he's gold to me, because it's kind of all built up to this point.
Yeah,
and there's so many memories associated with when we're getting to know each other being kind of golden.
Yes,
hell was the journey, but it brought me heaven.
Excellent lyric,
and really just makes you feel for all the shit she's been through.
And that's what I mean by like she has like so many little references to just being like, it's fine that I went through all of that.
Yeah,
because it's. I ended up with the right person in the end anyway.
Oh, it's
like
such
that's a perfect way of saying that.
It is perfect lyric to sum it all up, as she so perfectly does.
Yeah.
And yeah, just such a feel good song. Third time she changes it, and it's so interesting the words she uses after time each time, because it's time, wondrous time, you know, whereas before it was curious time
and mystical time.
So yeah, like the early stages was curious and mystical, and now it's wondrous because she understands it better and she's able to take the positives from time. Over time, all these things have happened, all these good things have happened, all this time has made me be a better person, it's made me grow, gave me the blues and then purple pink skies.
So it's like all of the all the hell was the blues.
Yeah.
And then purple pink skies. Lover.
Yeah.
Iconic. That's my favorite. They're my favorite lyrics in the whole song. I love that ending chorus and how she ties in lover and everything to that.
Yeah.
Rude. Love it.
Oh, love the word choice as well of isn't it just so pretty? Because it is pretty.
And the song is pretty. The feeling is pretty. Yeah. The plucking of the guitar is pretty.
Yeah.
I also such just think it's song. like, and I said this pretty soon after Folklore came out, I feel like of all the songs she's written about Joe, if I was Joe or if I had these, all of these songs written about me, this would be the one that I want, because I feel like it feels so secure, so happy, so light, so sure, so reflective.
Oh,
and
it's encompassing everything.
It is so pretty. Like it's such a nice song.
Oh, I know. And it's absolutely rude how many songs she's written for him. Like,
how it is
absolutely
would rude.
He deal?
Yeah.
Okay, the next song is Mad Woman. Oh, my God, so much to say. I love this song so much. Oh, such a vibe. This music already. This piano. You know she's gonna.
You can tell she's fucking mad. Oh, she's like, mad. Oh, I'm playing the piano. Yeah. And I'm angry.
Yeah, absolutely.
What did you think I'd say to that? Does a scorpion sting when fighting back? They strike to kill, and you know I will.
Oh.
I want to say that we got it so wrong the first time we listened to this,
because
we just assumed that it was Kanye and Kim, which, like, to be fair, that's a very valid thing to think, considering how many songs she's written about Kanye.
We just were not on the page of Scott and Scooter.
No, we didn't think that she'd write about that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which
it actually fits them really well still. Like, it does still fit Kim and Kanye a lot.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
But now we know that it's more likely to be about Scooter Braun and his wife Yale.
Yes.
And obviously just the fact that Scooter has purchased her music, and she has always disliked him even before buying her music for several different reasons. She felt bullied by him over the years.
So the way he does it as well is so manipulative and tactical, and like, and his wife as well has come out and said really mean things about Taylor on social media, and they just kind of team up on against her, and they've never been understanding of where she's coming from with wanting her music back. And I just love how that song starts, like, what did you think I would say to that?
Like, you knew that we didn't like each other. You knew we didn't have a good relationship. What did you think I would do if you purchased my music.
Exactly. And does the scorpion...
I would kill you.
Sting when fighting back. They strike to kill and you know I will. Like,
she's literally like, this is so fucking obvious. You should have seen this from a mile away.
I just love how badass it
is. It's so good. It's just,
what are you seeing on your drive home? Do you see my face in your neighbor's lawn? Does she smile? Or does she mouth fuck you forever?
Okay, well, first time on this album that she says fuck you, which I love. Well, she says it in Betty, but we haven't gotten to that
Betty,
yet.
Yes.
So she says, what are you singing on your drive home? Which is an important lyric that I feel like needs context in a way, because apparently that's based on a clip that Scooter had online somewhere where him and Justin Bieber are singing Teardrops on My Guitar
yep.
on their way home in the car when kind of like before all the drama went down.
I feel like it's kind of like pointing out like, oh, what you think about me.
Yeah.
And I know you think about
yeah,
me.
Yeah, yeah, and you always know my music.
Yeah.
You will always know my music.
Yeah.
Do you see my face in your neighbor's lawn? Does she smile or does she mouth fuck you forever? I always, when I first heard that lyric, I was a little bit confused. Like, does she mean she literally, you see her face everywhere? It's because I'm haunting you. And that's what I think I've come to.
Yes.
Yes, yeah.
That's what I take
yeah,
from it.
Yeah,
yeah.
And when you picture me, is she smiling?
Yeah.
Or is she saying, fuck you? That is such a powerful visual in someone's head.
Kind of saying, like, if
yeah.
you picture me
yeah.
smiling, just so you know, I'm absolutely not smiling. Like, I'm going to give you an alternative
yeah.
to think about.
That's really what I'm thinking. Yeah. It's also a very interesting lyric because it's kind of like, how aware are you? How self-aware are you, and how much are you
yeah.
willing to let yourself know how fucked up this is, what you've done?
Totally. It's like, how
are you in denial?
Are you, exactly. Mm. It's like, where does this sit on your conscience?
Yes.
Like, are you okay with what you've done?
Yeah.
Or do you think about the fact that you fucked me over and you know it?
Oh, wow. Talking about that lyric out loud's really
yeah.
brought it to life for
yeah.
me. Yeah. 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 Crazy, get more crazy. And I love how she says, what about that?
Yeah, what about that?
What about that?
What about that? We were having a conversation yesterday about like name calling in arguments, which is just like
so
doesn't get you anywhere.
No.
And it's like, you know, like, I feel like that's it too. It's just
yeah.
like, oh, she's just angry. She's just mad.
Oh.
She's just...
Well, not validating like, her emotion. That
she's just
crazy. Yeah.
And it's like, that just totally writes off any emotion that that person has because you can't deal with it.
Well, like, and it, yes.
and that's kind of, that she's kind of saying that you do deflect this off your conscience
yeah.
to be like, oh, she's just crazy.
Absolutely.
She's just
You're
mad.
Not listening
she's
to me.
She's just angry.
And that would be so infuriating if someone is calling you crazy. It does
yeah.
make you more crazy. And it's kind of like what, that's what this whole song is about, is like men or, you know, society make women crazy by not validating them and
yeah.
by telling them that they're crazy and stuff.
Yeah.
Because
and he
no
makes
one likes
himself,
a mad woman.
He makes himself feel better about what he's done by just being like, oh, well, you know, she's the crazy one. Like,
yeah.
look what she's doing.
Yeah.
Like, it's a
yeah.
shame she went that crazy, but she didn't have to.
Yeah.
She
yeah.
didn't have to be so
yeah.
mad about this.
Yeah.
She chose to be mad about this. And it's like, well, actually, no, she
That's
has every
exactly.
right to be mad about this.
Oh my God, that is exactly what it is.
Yeah.
And there's nothing like a mad woman. What a shame she went.
Such an interesting chorus, because the first bit's like, shame she went mad, kind of like putting
yeah.
their perspective in, because that's how they would, oh, mad woman, shame she went mad or whatever, shame that she's taking it like this,
mm.
her blaming it on her, putting
mm-hmm.
on her,
mm-hmm.
and then at the end of that chorus she says, you made her like that,
yeah,
which is also just such another powerful, powerful lyric and statement.
The most triggering thing
yeah.
ever in the world to have a man who like literally makes you that way.
Yes.
And then it's like, you're crazy.
Yeah.
I was like, what the fuck do you think I'm crazy?
Wow.
Oh my God. Relatable content. Oh, it's such relatable content. It's so and it's like up. Deeply triggering to hear her say this because I'm like,
because I'm sorry, men do that.
I'm so sick of men doing that.
Yeah.
What is with that?
What is
it is
with
so
that?
Manipulative yeah. and just like leaves no space for the other person, or I guess in this case, the woman, to feel anything. Like, you don't. Asshole, and then when I'm mad about it,
it's my fault.
It's my fault.
And you poke that bear till the claws come out, and you find something to wrap your noose around.
That lyric is also really powerful because she's saying, like, oh. Whatever I do, you paint it bad or you put your noose around it and make it 10 times worse.
You're the one that
they poke her.
Like, brought this out of
yeah,
me.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, what?
What do you expect? What do you expect?
I hate him.
Now I breathe flames each time I talk. My cannons all firing at your yacht, they say. Move on, but you know I won't.
This is her literally saying, I'm coming for you.
I'm here to destroy you.
My cannons all firing at your yachts. I love that she says yachts as well because yeah. it kind of paints them as like these rich, like.
Well, it's like,
dickheads,
I mean, isn't
I
it? Isn't it just that he's
yeah.
in it for the money?
Yeah.
Like, he wants to own all of her discography
yeah.
because. He knows that
yeah.
she is one of the most successful artists of all time and that her fans are going to continue to stream her music. And
yeah.
she, and also, like, the beef that they've obviously had in the past, like, this is just a way to one-up her as well.
Oh.
Which is so sly and conniving.
Yes, absolutely.
And it's like, you are just in this for the money. Like, you don't care what my art means to me. You don't care what anyone's art
no.
means to them. All you care about is being a fucking manager of Justin Bieber
yeah.
and making as much money as you possibly can
yeah,
off of everyone, whatever. The effort that everyone else makes. Like, I'm sorry, Scooter Braun, what kind of talent do you have?
Well,
except literally just managing everyone else.
No, and
useless.
And you can see how that's portrayed even in the way that Justin Bieber goes about things. Like, you know, literally telling his fans to do the most weirdest fucked up shit to get
his
songs to number one. Like, they have such a drive for fame and power and money
yep.
that Taylor Swift has never had. She wants people to... The only drive that Taylor's ever had is because she wants to be... recognized and appreciated for her talent.
And she just wants to be able to do what she loves
yes,
doing. It's
exactly.
not about how it charts. It's not about how much money am I going to make. It's not about getting it to number one. She just wants to do it because she's passionate about it. And she and nowadays as well, she wants to give something to back to her fans.
Yes, exactly. And that's why this song hits so hard. Like, even when she says, you know, they say move on, but you know I won't. Like,
yeah.
and you must know.
But also, why would I?
Exactly. And sometimes I really do think
it's my whole
that
life
he thought
that you own.
This was gonna go. This was gonna. She was gonna let this slide.
But
and
he's
that
stupid.
Maybe he would just own all her music and she would just keep moving on. But
no,
she's not gonna let this
no.
go.
When this bridge comes in,
oh.
I'm like, wait, this song was already so good. What do you mean?
I know.
I get this bridge
I
as
know.
Well. It's
I
so
know.
Superior.
I know. It's so good. And this song always feels like the equivalent to My Tears Ricochet, but for Scooter. Right? Because, like, My Tears Ricochet is for Scott. And now this is, like, because it's all the same things, right? Like, it's all, she's so mad. She's so upset.
She is. And the anger builds in the
yes.
bridge. And it's actually the same, it's the same structure
yeah.
as well. It's exactly the same structure as My Tears Ricochet.
It's,
and I know a lot of her songs are like that, but not all of them, especially on this album. They're not all like that.
No,
but these two songs are like that.
Yeah, and it's so interesting how the different energies that there are towards Scott and Scooter, right? Because, like,
yep.
towards Scott, it's like this betrayal. It's like this fatherly figure that's really hurt her feelings, and like it's her home that's been destroyed.
And she's a lot more loving in the way that she speaks about Scott. Even in My Tears Ricochet,
yeah.
she's like, I am hurt because you were meant to be my family.
Oh, absolutely.
We were meant to have a lifelong relationship. We were in this together. Whereas Scooter, she's just like, I just fucking hate you.
It's two completely different emotions. Two
yeah.
completely different emotions. Yeah.
yeah.
Scooter is like, you fucking dickhead.
Like, there's
like,
no loyalty to Scooter.
No.
Whereas, like, she's less hurt by Scooter and
yeah.
more just just like attacking because you yes. are the shittest person ever, where she's like deeply hurt.
I know.
By Scott.
And I love the lyrics, taking my time because you took everything from me, because I really feel like she's building yeah. up to like re-recording her albums yeah. and she's going to take everything back.
And also that's a scary everything thing back. To hear a Scooter Braun, because like, I'm sorry, you know Scooter Braun's heard this song. You know he knows yeah. it's about him.
Yeah.
And like to have her say like, I'm taking my time because you took everything from me. Like, I'm sorry, I'm scared. What are you gonna do?
I know.
This bitch has got something up her sleeve. I would be scared.
I would be Scooter so Braun, scared, darling.
Shaking in his boots. Shaking. Actually, like, threw me off, because I feel like referring to the wife
yeah.
and like the wife getting involved and also the wife having an affair.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
But like, that's where I also thought of Kim, because I'm like, Kim has gotten involved
yeah.
as well as Yale.
Yes.
So it's sort of like,
It could have been either. But I love that. And I love how it starts with Master of Spin, because I think that can be taken multiple ways. Like he spins everything as well.
Yeah.
But he's also a manager and owns the Masters to all these famous artists. So that's also an interesting take on it as well. And Master of Spin has a couple side flings a good wife always knows. So she's taking shots at their relationship
yeah.
and saying things like, almost like empathizing with Yael in a way, because she's like, she should be mad. She'd be scathing.
Mm.
Scathing is such a perfect word choice. And she should be scathing like Taylor, but no one likes a mad woman.
Yeah.
So yeah, like we kind of said that when we first reacted to it, like, but we were thinking of Kim and Kanye, which I do think could be a similar dynamic.
Yeah.
Shots fired?
Shots fired.
Absolutely.
This whole song is shots fired.
Such a powerful song. Probably, like,
iconic,
look, I'm going to go to as far as to say, underneath My Tears Ricochet, it's like her best fight back song that she's ever done. Like, in terms of, like, you know, this is why we can't have nice things. Like, I Did Something Bad was pretty good like that. But,
yes.
But
this is very
And Blank Space
written.
Obviously was
every
as well. But
new lyric in this song is T. Like, every lyric is T.
Every lyric is T. Check, there wasn't anything that we... Oh, we did. We missed that. We missed that lyric. And Women Like Hunting, which is too just...
I don't know why I thought it was just going into the chorus then.
No, that's yes. okay. We didn't play it, but just before the chorus as well, she brings up the wife again by saying, and women like hunting witches too, which I also love that she was referring to the witching thing again, because we talked about that and I Did Something Bad and
yep.
Rep as well, like kind of that... Just that
she's referring to herself as a witch again, like
yes.
she's the bad one
yes.
kind of thing.
Doing your dirtiest work for you, because Yale went on so many rants on Instagram, like trying to bring Taylor down and kind of like standing up for Scooter when he wouldn't. She was doing the dirty work for him in that regard, and that's why
Ew.
I thought of Kim when I first heard that lyric. But it makes so much sense as she's talking about these two,
totally, with like
context.
Releasing the video and that's and the National Snake Day.
Yeah.
Either way, you know, like even
every
if
lyric is
we're literally wrong and it is about Kanye and Kim, it's not it's, because I think the lyric "You Took Everything from Me" like really sums up who this is about.
Oh, absolutely.
But regardless, it's fitting for both couples. Mm. Both are shitty couples.
Yeah.
Both of you are worthy of these hideous
and you know,
lyrics.
Yes. Oh, absolutely. Both of them are worthy of that. And even Justin Bieber in a way. Because him and Hailey have constantly bullied Taylor as well, or constantly made little digs at her and stabs at her during this whole situation.
Imagine
I don't find that to be
person.
Acceptable in any way, because... As an artist, how can you not understand?
How can you not understand?
It makes sense because Justin Bieber doesn't write his own music. I mean, how could you understand?
How could you get it?
Yeah.
You don't get it.
It just goes to show anyone that's really getting Taylor's side is a different kind of human to Justin Bieber and Scooter and that lot. That gang. Anyway, superior song. Moving on to the next, which is Epiphany. Anything that we want to say before it starts?
Well, I mean, this is the one that we knew from what she had said in her, like, sort of, I guess, summary of the album before we listened to it for the first time. where she is referring to her grandfather at war.
Yes.
But damn, I love how she wraps that up into the whole COVID situation.
Yeah, I agree. It's so such good. An interesting song in the way that it covers a few different topics and kind of just like, I guess in a way it feels like it covers like the mood of the world.
Yeah.
And especially during this time.
Just painting that picture of like, oh, you'll be right.
Yeah.
And then kind of forcing them to go back out and then realizing actually this person's dying. Like we can't keep going the way we're going kind of thing so, I have no words.
It's like you're going through a lot of different feelings like that would only come in war, if that makes sense. And it's such a complex thing to try and describe. And some things you just can't speak about.
Mm.
This song is almost a bit like that. Like it's like a song that just is that you feel. And it's like, it's almost quite hard to talk about because I feel like it's in the music and it's in the lyrics, but it's very much so in the music
as well. It's a mood. The whole thing's a mood.
Yeah, the whole thing is such a mood.
Those lyrics in the chorus, if that's considered the chorus,
it is,
are we need to stick together.
Yeah, that's what it all is. Like,
yeah.
With you I serve, with you I fall down. What you breathe in, what you breathing out. It's like this unifying moment where they're coming together and through any difficult situation, that is the answer.
Yep.
Second verse is obviously where we go into COVID. Something med school did not cover. Such a simple way of wrapping up this this disaster of COVID because, the whole world was like, what the fuck do we do?
Don't know what to do with this. Yeah.
Like, we have to just... We didn't learn this.
No. That verse is obviously tying into the first verse and like the similarities between having to struggle with COVID and also having to struggle through war.
Yeah.
But also like kind of painting that picture of like in the past, the heroes have been the men who went off to war and today the heroes are the doctors.
Yeah, well that's
trying to save this.
Absolutely. There she says, hold your hand through plastic now, which is, I think, the most COVID lyric in the whole song in terms of obviousness. Doc, I think she's crashing out.
Mm-hmm.
She said she again there as well, but I don't know if that has any meaning.
Well, I think that's because she's talking about the patient.
Yes. Yeah.
So the daughter and the mother could either be a patient or they could be a nurse or a doctor because if they're crashing out, the choice of lyrics, I feel like, is very vague in that sense. It's like this whole verse could be about the patient crashing out.
Yep.
It could be the nurse crashing out because they're overworked during this whole scenario.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you're right. It could be about more. And some things we just can't speak about once again, ending it.
And how
hard this is. It's like she's trying to wrap up both two such catastrophic events happening in such little lyrics, but then ending them with some things we can't just speak about because it is a very overwhelming feeling to be going through these things.
Yeah.
Just one single glimpse of relief to make some sense of what you've seen.
perfect way to sum up both scenarios. Mm. Everyone having to go to war, mm-hmm. and everyone having to deal with coronavirus. Mm. Like, we just need some relief from this year.
Yeah.
But also, you know, in the past, people felt that we need some relief with this war.
Yeah, and it feels like it's like almost saying this is how we've always gotten through things in a way, because only 20 minutes to sleep is such an interesting lyric, because it's saying that you have this short period to sleep in, and by saying only, it gives this sense of like people being overworked or being in a very difficult situation, but you dream of some epiphany.
Mm-hmm.
Is that epiphany the hope? Is that epiphany what's getting us through in a way? Mm-hmm. Just one single glimpse of relief to make sense of what you've seen, because that is also so powerful, giving the imagery of what people see at war and what people have seen in this coronavirus state. Yeah.
It's
just a lot.
Yeah, it is a lot.
Like, it
is a lot.
It really is a lot. I don't know if you want to keep going.
She just repeats more of the same lyrics. But it's very deep, and I think it's very fitting, obviously, for this album and the sound of it, but also just a perfect way to sum up, like, how we need to come together during such difficult times as a society. That would be the way that we navigate these things, because it's certainly not feeling like that right now.
The importance behind that word is that moment in the song where
having like some sort of realization
to pull you through.
To pull you through to make, well, as she says, to make sense of everything, but also to maybe like an epiphany to come up with a way to deal with it.
You just need that stillness to be able to see that, to make sense of what you've seen. So yeah, it's a very powerful song.
Yeah.
The sound of it is also perfection.
Yeah.
Because it feels like it's giving you this moment of stillness.
Yeah, because it feels like her voice is almost like meshed in with the music. Like, there's not a stark contrast. It's almost like she's singing in tune with the music or something. Like, it's all blended together.
Like,
it's just a be still and hear this. Like, it's not like there's different parts to focus on. It's just the whole thing.
The whole thing is
one being.
Yeah, it's not obvious in the senses of it going through verses and chorus and bridges and stuff. It just feels like the flow of the sound of the music, and she's matched that in a moment of a feeling.
Yeah.
That song is a feeling captured.
Yep. Totally.
And it definitely sums up the feeling of this year for sure.